Welcome back to our second session in this study of the Gospel of John. In the first session, we spent most of our time thinking about the purpose of the Gospel of John, and we kind of closed with John and what it means for him to be the author and inspired by God in order to share this story of the life of Christ with us. So to review that quickly, in John 20, 30 and 31, John writes, "Many other miraculous signs did Jesus do in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you might have life in his name." So if we look at John's purpose across the board, he believes there is a quality of life, a kind of life that redefined what it meant for him to be alive. He was alive before he met Jesus. He had a good life or a full life or an experience of some kind. But he says, let me tell you something. After I met Jesus, my life changed. I didn't even think I had life once I met him, when he changed the quality of my life so deeply and pervasively. But John says, here's what happened. I met this guy. Of course, like John, he's a Jewish guy in the first century in Israel at the east end of the Mediterranean Sea. But John says, no, when I started hearing who he said he was and watched him do what he was able to do, then it made sense to me he was more than just this guy named Jesus. John says, I came to believe beyond a shadow of a doubt that Jesus of Nazareth in the first century was actually the Messiah that all history anticipates, and that he's the Son of God, and that in being the Messiah and the Son of God, he is the one that can deliver life. So John says, let me tell you what I did. There's all these file folders about Jesus, and you have these other three Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and they reveal to you things about Jesus, teachings about Jesus, long sermons of Jesus, parables of Jesus, all of these things, but I didn't take that approach. Luke had his approach, remember, kind of chronological. I'm putting all this in an orderly fashion so you can be sure of the things you've been taught. John says, I still have a different approach. I'm sharing these things with you, John says, so that you can believe. This isn't all there is to Jesus. There's more that you can learn from these other Gospels. But I'm giving you these so that you can believe. Another illustration we gave in session one was scene select, like a DVD. That John says, I didn't press play all on 33 years of Jesus' life. No, I chose these significant seven I am statements that are recorded in John. I chose these miracles, these seven key miracles, remember, that he calls signs, pointing toward faith. And John says, when I put all of this together, this is why I believe, and I want you to be able to believe as well. Now, who's the you? Well, that first century audience, John was writing initially to believers and citizens in the area of Western Turkey, modern-day Western Turkey, back then called Asia Minor, part of the Roman Empire. History tells us that he was on the island of Patmos when he wrote the book of Revelation, but other history tells us that he was living in Ephesus, perhaps, when he wrote the Gospel of John. So that first audience is that first century Ephesian audience. Beyond that, we talked about the date. Dating the Gospel of John, there's primarily external evidence for this, but most believe it was near the end of the first century, but after the fall of Jerusalem. Jerusalem's temple was destroyed in 70 AD, and so most people think, well, maybe the writing of the Gospel of John was at least 15 years after that, so we're dating it somewhere around between 85 and 95, maybe around 90 AD. One of the other things we asked the question about was, well, how do we know who wrote it? And the reality is, is that the only thing we can look to know for sure who might have written the book of John is internal and external evidence. The internal evidence, of course, being kind of that those cryptic sayings, those stories that identify the author, like that he's the one that Jesus loved, that he's the one who laid his head back against Jesus at the Last Supper. So these are stories that people knew were associated with John, and he uses those stories, especially in chapter 21, to identify himself as the author. External evidence comes from early Christian fathers who assigned the Gospel of John to John the Apostle. Now, we know a little bit about his story. John the Apostle grew up in Galilee. He had a brother, James, a father, Zebedee, and these were some of the earliest followers of Jesus. Their business partners were actually Simon Peter and Andrew, and they also grew up in that area. Now, Andrew was an early follower of John the Baptist. He's the one that came and got his brother. And so we don't know for sure how much interaction that John and perhaps his brother James had with John the Baptist, but we do know that Andrew had that influence very early on. And interestingly enough, John the Apostle has a tremendous amount to say about John the Baptist. Now, moving beyond that, we have another discussion we want to enter at this time. And that is to ask the question, how do we understand the placement of the Gospel of John in Scripture and in history? So that's where we're going to start in this session. When people ask the question about the Bible, one of the things they want to know is it the Word of God? Can I trust that? And should I even believe that? Many years ago, this question was sensationalized by the movie The Da Vinci Code, written by Dan Brown. You may recall that movie, but it was sensationalized because throughout the movie, he took quite a few liberties with fiction and nonfiction, but he presented it in his book as if it was all true. Well, there were a lot of historians, whether they were believers or not, that made it crystal clear that it was not true, that many of the claims he made in the book were not substantiated or in the movie. Well, at least what this did was this aroused people's interest in, so how did we actually get our Bible? Elaine Pagels has written extensively on this, and she discusses the canon a certain way. Bart Ehrman, another scholar, has written extensively about this. What I would like to do is I would like to give you kind of a basic framework for thinking about what is in Scripture and what is not. All of this asking the question, is the Gospel of John truly the Word of God? So the word canon, not spelled like the thing you shoot, spelled with only one N, C-A-N-O-N, canon, literally, as best we can tell from its history, has to do with measurement. Some people think that maybe it came from a Hebrew word that would be spelled with English letters, maybe K-A-N-E-H, kaneh, the idea of that being a reed. A reed was used like how we use a yardstick or a tape measure. It was a way to measure something. So the word canon has to do with how we measure whether something belongs in or out. So if you could imagine canon like a circle, it measures what qualifies for something to be in, but it also determines what would qualify something to be out. So let's think about Shakespeare. We have what we could call the Shakespeare canon, the authentic works of William Shakespeare. Well, how would you determine that? What if somebody wrote something and signed his name, but it wasn't really him? How would we determine that? Well, you could look at literary style, timing. You could look at those the way he uses words. You could look at when it was published. Was it published during his lifetime, after his lifetime? In his case, you could look at penmanship. You could compare it to other authentic Shakespearean writings. So there's all these ways that you could kind of look and see, do I really think this is part of the Shakespearean canon? Well, the same thing is true with Scripture. Some people kind of take a conspiracy theory view, kind of like Dan Brown, where, you know, for politically motivated reasons, people kept this gospel in, kicked that gospel out. They wanted to advance certain beliefs about Jesus and so on. I'm not much for the conspiracy view. The way that you study canon is much more detailed, much more scientific, much more based in research. So several questions people would ask would be, is the writing of the Gospel of John comparable to what other people call the Johannine corpus? The Johannine, based on the name John, represents five books in the New Testament. The Gospel of John, 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, and Revelation. So what they're looking at is, do those five books basically use similar vocabulary? Are there literary characteristics that would be similar between the five books? Are they dated at a similar time? Can they be traced back to a similar time? All of those are part of the scientific research of canon. And so we're going to look at those over the next few moments. So now as we look at these, what I want to start with is going back to the date. When you look at the Johannine corpus, basically we're looking at the end of the first century. Did you know that the Apostle John is the only one of the original 12 apostles that died a natural death? We know Judas took his own life. All the rest of them were martyred. Do you know who the first apostle was to be martyred? It was John's brother, James. This is actually recorded in the book of Acts in the New Testament in chapter 12. It was when they were young followers of Jesus. John carried in his heart for perhaps 5 decades the loss of his brother for faith in Christ Jesus. You see, John's family didn't take this lightly, especially James and John. So John lived near the end, they lived out his life near the end, approximately around maybe the late 80s and 90s AD. He lived in Ephesus. So when you think about the Gospel of John being written at that time, one of the things you're looking for, especially in Revelation and so on, is do the writings match the time? Now, if you could think about this then, you basically have the first original audience, which would have been around somewhere between 75 and 95 AD in Western Asia Minor, modern-day Western Turkey. So that's the first audience that received this book, okay? Now, the stories themselves in the book are centered in Jesus Christ. So those stories actually take place around 27 to 30 AD. Now, that may catch some of you off guard if you're listening carefully, so I need to step back and speak to this. What year was Jesus probably crucified? What would most people say? 33 AD, right? Have you heard that? Some people would say, yep, it was 33 AD, and that's when the church was started. It was in 33 AD. Well, I know why we did that. There was a calendar that was used all the way up into the early 1500s called the Julian calendar. But in the 1500s, we switched over from the Julian calendar to what has become known as the Gregorian calendar. This is the most widely used civil calendar in the world. It's the one we still use today. The Gregorian calendar is also called the Christian calendar. The purpose of this is that the original Julian calendar was slightly off in dating. So when they corrected it with the Gregorian calendar, then it was retroactive. So all the way back to what we would call what? Zero. They had to correct the calendar. And when they did, it adjusted all those early dates by a few years. So scholars will often say, and I know it's confusing, they'll say, well, Jesus was probably born between 4 and 6 BC. And you're like, wait a minute. Doesn't BC mean before Christ? How could he be born before Christ? Don't let it throw you off. It doesn't change when Jesus was born. It just changes how we calculate the calendar accurately. So the original dating of Jesus' final ministry is probably between 27 and 30 AD, right around in there. Do you know what AD means? Some people think after death. No, it's a Latin term, Anno Domini, which means year of our Lord. So some people use BC, before Christ, AD, year of our Lord, Anno Domini. Some people will use CE, current era, or BCE, before current era. Don't get thrown off by these things. They're not negative, they're not bad. They're just ways that people are trying to represent accurately the timing of these events. So the stories in the Gospel of John happened in Israel around 27 to 30 AD. That's the ministry of Jesus. John's first audience lived around 85 to 95 AD in Western Asia Minor, Western modern Turkey. So the stories, Israel, 27 to 30. The recipients, Western Turkey, 85 to 95. So one of the things we begin right away to notice in the Gospel of John is that some of the stories about Jesus had some weird explanations to them. This tells us a little bit about John's audience. So I want to take a moment and talk about his audience. First of all, as I mentioned in the first session, John's audience is separated from the original events of the ministry of Jesus by chronology and geography. So let me speak to that for a few moments. John's gospel explains things about geography. Well, if his gospel was written to Jews from Israel, they wouldn't have to explain geography. For instance, if I tell you that I live in Atlanta and you're from Atlanta, you know exactly what I'm talking about. But if I was to say to someone, hey, listen, I live in Atlanta, Georgia, and it's in the southeast United States, well, then clearly I'm explaining that to somebody that is not familiar with the United States. One of my children and his wife have been missionaries in Russia for a number of years. When their friends communicate with us, then sometimes I will say to them, we live in Atlanta, Georgia, in the southeast United States. When people ask me, well, where do your kids live? I tell them, well, they live in Siberia, on the edge of Siberia and Russia, the Ural Mountains, and they kind of look at you kind of strange. I say, 1,000 miles east of Moscow. They still look at me kind of strange. The reason is because they're not familiar with it, okay? So when John explains things geographically, that gives us a clue as to his audience. They're either not primarily a Jewish audience, or if they are, they're not Jews that are familiar with Israel. The better possibility, and I want you to hear this carefully, is that John's audience is probably not primarily Jewish. It's primarily non-Jewish or Gentile. And we learn that through these clues. Now, here's a few other things that are kind of interesting in the gospel. We notice in chapter 2, there's a history of Jesus cleansing the temple. In all the other gospels, Jesus cleanses the temple at the end of his ministry. In John's, it's recorded at the beginning. It's only in John's gospel that it is recorded that Jesus went through Samaria and met the woman at the well in chapter 4. One of the other things we notice in the Gospel of John is it records Jesus going up to the Passover feast as an adult 3 distinct times. And so that helps us to see his ministry and evidence of his ministry for 3 full years. And so another thing we notice in the Gospel of John is that there is a little bit of a difference between what happens at the final Last Supper, what we call the Last Supper in the upper room, than the other 3 Gospels. In fact, imagine this. Matthew, Mark, and Luke each dedicate approximately 2 chapters or so to those events. John dedicates chapters 13, 14, 15, 16, and 17 to those events. 5 chapters. It is only in John that we hear of Jesus washing the disciples' feet at the Last Supper. So it's a very distinct gospel, a very distinct story. Now here's another clue to John's audience. explanations. Matthew's gospel appears to have been written primarily to a Jewish audience. Many scholars have noticed this throughout the years. Matthew's gospel actually begins with the genealogy of Jesus, kind of making it clear that he's identified with the prophecies of the Old Testament, identified with Abraham, identified with King David. These are very significant. But none of this is in the Gospel of John. In fact, none of it. So as you look through this, here are some things that are in the Gospel of John. There's no way that the audience was primarily Jewish, or if it had a large Jewish element, they were not apparently knowledgeable of some key things in their religion or culture. Here's a few things that we notice. First of all, in John's gospel, he explains many things. Like, for instance, he will explain what the word rabbi means. He will say, rabbi means teacher. Every Jewish person already knew that. He'll explain the Passover feast. What American would have to explain the 4th of July? Unless you were talking to someone who's not from our culture or our history. In the Gospel of John, he explains the Pool of Bethesda and the meaning of that. He explains where things are, what words mean. He explains religious customs. Now, if you're Jewish, you don't have to have any of those things explained to you. So, you know, if I could lay this out and compare it, you know, you look at the Gospel of Matthew. Primarily, the signals are, is written to primarily Jewish audience. Contrast that with Luke. Luke uses the word Jew or Jews in his gospel 5 times. John, in the Gospel of John, uses it 70 times. Now, a brief illustration would help us understand that. If somebody was talking to me and they kept saying, well, you Americans, you American, you American, you American, I might finally say, I got it. I'm American. But the same thing would be true if somebody said the same thing to someone from Britain or from Nigeria, from Kenya. If they kept referring to them by their nationality, eventually someone might think, are you speaking to us or about us? Okay? So then, I can't imagine someone in Ukraine saying, well, you know those Ukrainians this and those Ukrainians that, if they're Ukrainian. But the newscasters on the outside might say something like, well, this is what is going on with the Ukrainian government. This is what's going on with the Ukrainian people. So one is talking to, one is talking about. The evidence in John's gospel, when he's talking about the people of Israel, is he's talking about them. When he's talking about the geography of Israel, he's talking about it. That's why he clarifies so many things, like vocabulary and like geography. Now, another thing you'll notice in the Gospel of John is the distinct symbolism. This is one of the reasons that people attribute the Gospel of John, internal evidence, to the other Johannine corpus, 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, and Revelation. There's great symbolism in the Gospel of John, and it identifies with these other letters. We need to learn the details about these, and we'll look at it further through our study, but what I'd like to do is talk about the symbolism in the Gospel of John and how it portrays Jesus and his ministry. So throughout the Gospel of John, you have light and dark. Light, representative of Jesus, his ministry, the truth. You know, I am the light of the world. But darkness, representing evil or the opposing forces of God. So remember, it says in chapter 1 that in him was life, and his life was the light of men. The light appeared, but the darkness was unable to overcome it. This is part of the symbolism. Jesus talks about, as does John the Baptist in the Gospel of John, about things from above and things from below. Throughout the Gospel of John, those that are followers of God, faithful to God, followers of Jesus, these are from above. Jesus is from above. Jesus is the bread. Remember, he said, I am the bread of life. But see, he says, I'm the bread from above. So things are from above and things are from below. There's also good and evil, God and Satan, believers and unbelievers, the kingdom of God, and the ways of the world. So all of these are powerful symbols, but there's other symbols in the Gospel of John. So Jesus is a lamb, right? But Jesus is also a good shepherd. So when we look at the Gospel of John, we see different symbols, some overlapping the other Gospels, some unique. So there's symbolism in the Gospel of John, and this is very strong symbolism. Now I want to speak for a moment about literary style and content. Closely tied to the idea of symbolism is the literary style and the way that John tells the story of Jesus. Real quickly, what is your favorite parable from the Gospel of John? Your favorite parable? Well, that was kind of a trick question. There are no parables in the Gospel of John. That's one of the things that makes it unique. There are no parables. You say, really? Really? There are parables in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And we're familiar with those parables, right? So there's the parables, remember, of the kingdom. So the parable of the good soil, the parable of the mustard seed, the parable of the fish and the net and the wheat and the tares, all of these parables. There are no parables in the Gospel of John. Here's the next thing that's interesting. In most of the other three Gospels, you have these extended sermon sections, like Matthew. You have the Sermon on the Mount, Matthews 5, 6, and 7. Well, that's mirrored in Luke chapter 6 with his account of the Sermon on the Mount. We have the kingdom parables and the kingdom teachings of Jesus, lengthy, lengthy discourses. We also have the woes against the Pharisees in Matthew 23. None of that is in the Gospel of John. There are no extended sermons in the Gospel of John. There are no parables in the Gospel of John. So some people think, well, maybe John is presenting a different Jesus. It's possible, but that's not how it is. John is using a different literary style to explain the same Jesus. So let me give you an example of this. Remember in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5 and verse 9, Jesus declares, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. That phrase is nowhere in the Gospel of John. But in John chapter 8, we have it recorded where Jesus meets this woman caught in the act of adultery. You remember this story? It's recorded in John 8, 1 through 11. It's a story of them, these accusers dragging this woman before in the temple courts and before the crowds early in the morning. It's a crazy scene, and they're demanding that Jesus do something in the law. Moses commanded we stone such women. What do you say? And there's all this emotion. But what ends up happening? Do you remember the story? You might want to take a moment and read it in John 8. Here's what happened. Jesus slows everything down. The Bible says he bent down, drew in the ground. We don't know what he drew or wrote. Then he stands up. Everybody's watching. Jesus says, okay, so to the accusers, any of you without sin, cast the first stone. Then what does the Bible say? Well, then he bent down, drew in the ground again. And what ends up happening? The Bible says, beginning with the oldest, one at a time, each of the accusers just kind of slinks away. Then what happens? Jesus turns to the woman. Hey, where are your accusers? Any of them hang around? No, none of them hang around. Okay, then go now. Leave your life of sin. You're not condemned. What did Jesus do? He made peace. He was a peacemaker. So in Matthew, Jesus gives the sermon and the teaching. Blessed are the peacemakers. In John, John uses interaction. He uses an interface. John teaches the same lesson, shows the same example as a peacemaker, but this time instead of Jesus teaching it, Jesus is the living lesson. So the same Jesus, the same values, the same teachings that are in the Synoptic Gospels are in the Gospel of John. It's just that rather than relaying the teaching, primarily, he's relaying the instance or the circumstance. Do you remember Jesus said over and over in the other Gospels, he's recorded as saying, whoever exalts himself will be humbled, but whoever humbles himself will be exalted. Now you realize in John 13, it's nowhere in there. But what does Jesus do in John 13? He gets up from the dinner, takes off his outer garment, wraps a towel around him, and begins to wash the disciples' feet. So see, once again, John isn't recording the verbal teaching of Jesus on humility. He's showing the circumstance, the interaction with others, and teaching the same lesson through the interaction. So Jesus ends that section by saying, do you know what I've done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you're right, for so I am. So if I washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. I have given you an example that you should do for each other as I've done for you. Notice John doesn't record him as saying, I've given you a teaching. That's Matthew style. I've given you an example. But is it not the same lesson? So it's not two different Jesuses. It's not like John's gospel is presenting some other Jesus. It's presenting the same Jesus, but in a different literary style and a different content. Now, how would we apply this to ourselves? Think about it this way. We have the same Jesus, the same ministry, and the same core message. What is that core message? Is that Jesus is the Messiah, God's Son, and that by believing Him in Him, you would have life in His name. But Matthew is primarily writing to a Jewish audience. So he writes in such a way that they would get to know Jesus. John is writing to primarily a Gentile audience who needs explanations about Jewish words, Jewish customs, Jewish religious practices, and the Israelite countryside. They were not there when the events of the life of Jesus took place. They weren't eyewitnesses. They aren't eyewitnesses of the terrain or the practices. So all of those things are explained in the Gospel of John when necessary. So what John does is he uses a literary content and a literary style that will connect with the audience he's trying to reach. Is there a lesson in that for us? That we would listen to Jesus and share Jesus with others cognizant of where they come from and what they might need help understanding. John's gospel shows us the way to communicate Jesus to unique cultures. So I begin to think to myself, how could we connect with John's gospel personally? So here's what I'd like you to do. Think about this. If there are seven I am statements in the Gospel of John, remember Jesus saying, I am the bread of life, I am the light of the world, I am the way, the truth, and the life, I'm all those things. I started wondering, what would I say were my seven I am statements? What would you say? So I might say, well, I am Don McLaughlin, I'm married to Susan, we've been married almost 32 years at the filming of this. I might say I'm the father of five children, and that in 2013, I became a grandfather of a wonderful granddaughter. See, these are my I am statements. I might say that I am a believer. I might say that I am passionate about the kingdom of God reflecting the diversity of God's world and God's kingdom. I'm passionate about reconciling people to each other and to God. See, these are my I am statements. You have some I am statements that describe you. Maybe another way to look at it would be, what are some of the things that I do that give people clues to who I am? See, just like John uses the miracles as signs that point to Jesus' identity, maybe what I would do is I would use my actions to point to my identity. So if someone comes over to my house and they go to my garage, it becomes evident after a while that I'm a mechanic. And the way they know that is because I do that kind of work, right? So a friend of mine, somebody might go and look on their Facebook page or get to know them a little bit, find out, well, this one's a basketball player. This one's a school teacher. This one serves in social work. Our actions, our consistent actions, declare something about who we are. See, they don't do it perfectly, but combined, they give an accurate picture. What we say about ourselves and what we do give people at least an awareness of who we are. Well, in the middle of the Gospel of John, we see a final component I want you to know about. John records the most extensive array of personal conversations out of all of the Gospels. He records intimate conversations with people, lengthy. No other gospel has the extensive conversations that John has. And in those conversations, we find out who Jesus is. Jesus has a conversation, a famous conversation, with Nicodemus. We learn a lot about him in that conversation. Jesus has a conversation with his mother at the turning of the water to wine. Jesus has a conversation with the man that he heals at the pool of Bethesda. He has a really long conversation with the lady he meets at the well, the woman that struggled with 5 broken marriages. Well, in all these conversations, the conversation with Mary and Martha at the death of Lazarus, the conversation with the blind man in chapter 9, the conversations with his disciples in chapters 13, 14, 15, the conversation with the Greeks in chapter 12, all of these conversations John uses to add one key element. Who does Jesus want you to believe he is? The I am statements reveal, the miracles confirm, and then these conversations, John has this myriad of conversations because he wants you to imagine yourself in the conversation. John wants you not just to see Nicodemus in chapter 3, he wants you to see yourself. He doesn't just want to see the lame man that's healed in chapter 5. He wants you to put yourself on that mat and have this dialogue with Jesus. In chapter 8, with the woman caught in adultery, Jesus doesn't just want you to know that he helped that woman. He wants you to help you. He wants to help you when you're struggling. That whole conversation with that woman who's been through 5 wrecked marriages in chapter 4, it's not just for then, it's also for now. The discussion with Mary and Martha when they've lost their brother, I'll bet some of you that are listening right now have lost a loved one. At the filming of this, I just lost my father, one of the closest people in the world to me. So John chapter 11 isn't just some historical story about Jesus and a buddy that died and 2 grieving sisters. He wants me to hear what he says to Mary and Martha. So not only do I see what he said then, but I can apply it now. So when you think with me about how we will study and interpret the Gospel of John, let's summarize. It is unique in the 4 Gospels. It doesn't present a different Jesus. It presents the same Jesus a different way. It does not use parables or extensive sermons. It uses key interactions, key examples, circumstances where Jesus is interacting with myriads of crowds. It uses signs, and it uses these I am statements to tell us who Jesus is. The gospel relays the events of Jesus' ministry, 27 to 30, but it is originally to an audience at the end of the first century, 85 to 95 AD, that is primarily Gentile in Western, modern-day Turkey, Western Asia Minor, probably centered around the city of Ephesus. We also recognize that the stories in the Gospel of John are there according to scene select, according to file folders. John uses them specifically so that we can believe that Jesus is the Christ, that he really is the Son of God, and that when we believe that and trust that, that we can have life in his name. In our next section, we're going to begin in chapter 1, so I'd ask you to read it ahead of time, and I look forward to seeing you then.